Thank you for tuning in to Beast Watch News News Brief at the most current and comprehensive Bible prophecy website on the internet, beastwatchnews.com. All Bible prophecy news, all the time. Stay tuned for news. In Israel, the U.S. will drop the peace process if Israelis and Palestinians are not serious, a senior American official has warned in an article by Arshad Mohammed, the Reuters journalist responsible for covering the State Department in Washington. The reporter cited those who called Kerry a lone ranger condemning the Middle East peace process and that many involved called Kerry naive. The U.S. senior official disputed the notion that Kerry was naive and said the Obama administration was prepared to abandon the effort if it decides the two sides are not genuine about pursuing peace. That's what shows he's not naive, said the official. Kerry's deadline for deciding whether there is any point in continuing diplomatic efforts to renew talks is nearing, while both sides are hardening their negotiating positions. Kerry expects answers from Jerusalem and Ramallah within 2 weeks. Abbas is not responding to American and Jordanian pressure, and Abbas has reiterated to Judea of Jordan that a freeze on settlement construction and the release of Palestinian prisoners is the way to create an atmosphere that will allow for negotiations to restart. Livni leaves today for Washington to hear Kerry's West Bank proposals. The key proposals, which were presented May 28th, include, number one, Kerry wants Israel to permit the Palestinians to build in Jericho. Number two, Palestinian authorities would be in charge of security at the future Jericho airport, while Israel would maintain control of passengers and freight traffic. Three, Kerry envisages the transformation of the entire Jericho region north of the Dead Sea and near the Jordanian border into a busy hub for galvanizing the economy of the future Palestinian state. Four, Israel is to hand over to the Palestinians the Acalia region on the northern shore of the Dead Sea. Five, Israeli concessions would not end at the northern Dead Sea coast, according to the secret Kerry plan. And six, Palestinians would also be awarded by the process a 3-year economic reconstruction program for boosting their gross national product by 50% and slashing unemployment from 21 to 8%. This is the biggest, boldest, and most ambitious program ever granted the Palestinians since Oslo 20 years ago, Kerry has said. Netanyahu has not divulged his views on the Kerry proposals, merely for winning Palestinian consent to talk peace, since the payment of sovereign Israel territory would be no more than the down payment for pulling the Palestinians to the table. How many more high-value security and national assets will Israel be required to part with along the road toward meeting the Palestinians' ever-rising price tag? Yes, indeed, that is the question. And Kerry is going to visit Jordan within days, according to the Jerusalem Post. Jordan's Foreign Minister Nasser Judeh said his own visit to Ramallah was part of the major effort by the Americans to restart the negotiations. He also said the U.S. was serious about ensuring Palestinian rights within the framework of a two-state solution. Judeh gave Abbas a letter from King Abdullah II concerning the latest developments in the diplomatic process and said his visit was part of coordination between Jordan and the PA. The Jordanian minister told reporters that the kingdom was hiding intensive contacts with several countries to support the efforts of the Palestinian leadership. PLO chief negotiator Saeb Erekat denied talking about joint Israeli-Jordanian control over the region. The Jordan Valley is a Palestine-Jordanian border, and Israel has nothing to do with it, Erekat said. He added that the Palestinians were opposed to any Israeli presence in the Jordan Valley. Israeli diplomatic officials would not relate to the report. Israel is demanding that it retain security control of the Jordan Valley in any agreement, especially in light of the regional uncertainty. The Palestinians are demanding full control of the area. A Palestinian official has said that Abbas also is opposed to the idea because such talks have not achieved anything in the past. According to the official, the Palestinians' treat would turn against Abbas and the PA leadership if they agreed to return to the negotiating table unconditionally. Malki said that both the Palestinians and Jordanians were working toward making Kerry's mission succeed. Erekat said that Kerry's current efforts were not open-ended, and he denied that Kerry was trying to arrange a meeting between Israel Israeli and Palestinian negotiators in Washington next week. Canada is training Palestinian troops as part of a controversial plan to create a security force in the West Bank. Western countries have helped train and equip more than 8,000 Palestinian security troops, as well as thousands of police and other officers, despite misgivings from both sides of the Arab-Israeli conflict. Under War and Peace, according to Debka File, Israeli Arrow 2s are ready for Syrian missiles, and U.S. Patriots are headed for Jordan, and Moscow is backing Hezbollah. Debka File's military sources report a high degree of operational coordination between the U.S. Patriot deployments in Jordan and Turkey, and the Israeli 2 preparedness for a potential missile attack, which could come from Iran, Syria, Lebanon, or the Gaza Strip. Another component of this missile shield is the Aegis ballistic missile defense system aboard U.S. warships in the Mediterranean. Moscow, for its part, continues to sow confusion about the delivery of its S-300 anti-air missile batteries to Syria, but has shown its hand on another issue by blocking a UN Security Council motion that would have condemned Hezbollah. Tabled under the heading of a declaration of alarm over Qusair, the council was asked to express grave concern over the dire events in that town since Hezbollah forces fighting with the Syrian army captured most of its urban area. Syria claims that there has been a sarin seizure at a rebel hideout. Syrian Arab News Agency reports that sarin, together with automatic rifles, pistols, and homemade bombs, was seized in the Faraya neighborhood of the city of Hama on Saturday. Meanwhile, John McCain says the Syrian rebels are being massacred. When he came back from a surprise visit to Syria, he offered his bleakest assessment yet of the hostilities there, saying that opposition fighters were being massacred and that Bashar al-Assad was beginning to tighten his grip on power. John McCain said, "Remember all this talk we've heard for the last year or two, that it's inevitable Bashar al-Assad will fail? Well, I think we can't make that statement today." Assad controls only 40% of Syria, though, says Ya'alon, and the Syrian rebels are still pleading for military help, while Russia says the U.S. is not putting enough pressure on Syria opposition. And in Lebanon, 4 more people are dead in clashes in Tripoli between the Sunni rebels and Hezbollah. At the Asian Security Summit held in Singapore, found the defense heads of Japan, South Korea, and the U.S. having sideline meetings regarding North Korea's nuclear weapons program. Itanori Onodera, Kim Kwon-jin, and Chuck Hagel all agreed to make sure that the North poses no further nuclear threat to Northeast Asia as well as the rest of the world. It was their first trilateral talks in 5 years. The released statement said the three ministers affirmed that they will continue their collaboration to deter North Korean threats of nuclear and missile development and further provocative acts. The trilateral agreement involves a strong call for the North to comply with the obligations pursuant to the UN Security Council resolutions, which include the abandonment of nuclear weapons and programs. Should these nations succeed in their aim, there might be no need for the international community to pursue a more aggressive means to stop North Korea. And China, India, Pakistan are all boosting their nuclear arsenals, according to one study, and there is now a big ruckus going on the internet involving a video on how to make a big bomb. Iran has scored another aviation breakthrough. It recently announced the development of a new stealth UAV called HIMARSE. It looks a lot like the RQ-7 Shadow 200, which is used by the U.S. Army. An RQ-7 crashed inside Iran 8 years ago, and Iran showed off the wreckage. No stealth features were noted in the pictures of HIMARSE, nor were the stealth features of the HIMARSE described in any detail. It simply looks like Iran copied the RQ-7 as best they could and added stealth to make it all sound more impressive. Iranian General Gholam Reza Jalali, head of the Iran's passive defense organization, in a recent event discussed defensive and offensive measures for cyber attacks and viruses. He talked about the strategic importance of using viruses as weapons to contaminate an environment. He said that viruses are very clever and have the capability to distinguish their environment, and these viruses can only be recognized in labs, he said, stressing these agents are easily hidden in the environment and can cause widespread epidemics. Istanbul has erupted into a Turkish Arab Spring. Turkish riot police have used tear gas and water cannons since last Friday to end a peaceful sit-in by hundreds of people trying to prevent trees from being uprooted in an Istanbul park. The dawn raid ignited a furious anti-government protest that took over the city's main square and spread to other cities and is now in its fourth day. 1,700 protesters have been arrested after riots broke out across the country. Under U.S. and world economy, Dubai shares are soaring to their highest since 2008 as HSBC is stoking its MSCI bets. Investors believe the United Arab Emirates could be upgraded to emerging market status at MSCI. The feds are going to spend nearly $500,000 to teach survival skills to fish, all the while looking down its nose at American preppers who are trying to teach themselves survival skills as well. And manufacturing has shrunk in the U.S. at its fastest pace in 4 years, according to the latest report. And here's a shocker. Nearly two-thirds of Americans who currently lack health insurance don't know yet if they will be able to purchase coverage by the January 1st deadline set by the ACA, a new survey revealed on Monday. And less than half of those in the survey released by InsuranceQuotes.com think they'll be able to get better health care after Obamacare takes full effect. Nearly 50% believe the ACA will make it more difficult for them to get tests and procedures done in a timely manner. And guess what? The cheapest plan will be $20,000 per family. The new acting commissioner of the IRS, Danny Werfel, is scheduled to make his first congressional appearance today as the embattled agency faces new questions over claims that its targeting of conservative groups was directed by Washington and a report that the agency spent millions on conferences. Interviews with an IRS field agent involved in the division that targeted Tea Party groups for additional vetting appear to contradict the White House's assertion that rogue agents and not the administration were behind the effort, according to partial transcripts released on Sunday by the House Oversight and Government Reform Committee. The agent in the Cincinnati office who made the claims told congressional investigators that he or she was told by a supervisor in March of 2010 to search for Tea Party groups applying for tax-exempt status and that Washington, D.C. wanted some cases. The agent said that by April, the office had held up roughly 40 cases and at least 7 were sent to Washington. The agent also said a second IRS employee asked for information on 2 other specific applicants in which Washington was interested. Under New World Order and Islam, a Florida courthouse will be the first in the nation to have an atheist monument. Bradford County Courthouse, which already has a Decalogue display outside its building, will have a large granite bench placed by the National Organization of the American Atheists in late June. Bill Killian, U.S. Attorney for the Eastern District of Tennessee, told the Tullahoma News that inflammatory or hateful posts could potentially run afoul of the law. This is an educational effort with civil rights laws as they play into freedom of religion and exercising freedom of religion, he told the newspaper. This is also to inform the public what federal laws are in effect and what the consequences are. I guess he expects us to be careful what we say. Under man-made and natural disasters, click on beastwatchnews.com to read more about the largest ever landslide that dropped 165 million tons more than a half mile wide down a copper mine in Utah. And nearly 3,000 people from some 700 homes are under evacuation orders as a wildfire north of Los Angeles has just kept growing, feeding on old dry brush, some of which hadn't burned in decades. The blaze has turned about 35 square miles in the mountains and canyons of the Angeles National Forest, destroying at least 6 homes and damaging 15 more. Under biological warfare, if you post articles to your Facebook wall that warn others about the dangers of vaccines, or if you tweet links to the latest studies tying vaccines to autism through Twitter, the vaccine pushers of the world could soon know about it in real time. According to new reports, Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation-backed scientists in both the U.S. and Great Britain have jointly developed a computerized global monitoring system capable of tracking down all social media activity around the world that defies mainstream vaccine dogma, and it will be reported directly to the authorities if you speak out against the vaccines. During a talk at the Hay Literary Festival in Wales last Wednesday, Catherine Taylor was asked what positive developments she anticipated in neuroscience in the next 60 years, and here's what she said. One of the surprises may be to see people with certain beliefs as people who can be treated. According to the Times of London, somebody who has, for example, become radicalized to a cult ideology, like, let's say, Christianity, for instance, or Judaism. We might be able to stop seeing that as a personal choice that they have chosen as a result of pure free will, and they start treating it as some kind of mental disturbance. She said these beliefs are very harmful, but are not normally categorized as mental illness. This is Beastwatch News Daily Update. See these and other stories at beastwatchnews.com. Bible prophecy news every day except Shabbat.